Father, we give everything to you today. We don't hold anything back today. Everything that's within us, God. Everything in our hearts, everything in our lives, we give it all to you today. The good things we give to you today. The bad things we give to you today. God, we give you everything. Let it not just be lip service, but let our hearts truly be abandoned for the cause of Christ. Lord, we say all the time, I'd give my life for you, I would die for you. But Lord, I ask that we would be a church that lives fully for you, Lord, transformed. Every day of our lives, let us live with abandon to you, to your plan, to your purpose, to your kingdom, God. Father, we repent for holding back from you. We're sorry where we haven't given it all to you, God. May we be a people that gives everything for you, God. Those little things that we want to keep, Lord, let us give them to you with everything within us, Lord. Because, God, we know that when we give you our wretchedness, our wickedness, and our sin, you give us Christ. You give us your righteousness. Lord, when we give you the worst things about us, you take it and you transform it and you use it for good. And God, those things that we have that are great and wonderful, God, they're nothing in comparison to who you are. And God, you can do something better with it anyway. So we give everything to you this morning, God, knowing that you'll transform it. And God, we thank you for the transformation that's happening in our hearts, in this church, in this community. God, that's happening across the nation, Lord. The powerful Spirit of God spoke mightily this week that we will not stand for unrighteousness. And we thank you, God, for transforming the hearts and minds of people. But God, we give our nation fully into your hands and say, have your way. These next 4 years, have your way, because it's not about political parties, but God, it's about your kingdom. So we give it all to you and say, God, have your way in our leadership. Have your way in our country. Have your way in America, Lord, that we would be a nation that truly, truly trusts in you with our whole heart, God. No longer holding back, but giving everything for your kingdom, for your glory. We thank you and we praise you. God, transform us this week. Transform us today. May we not be the same people we were last week. It's only by your Spirit. It's only by your power. We thank you, we praise you, and we glorify the name of Jesus. In your mighty, holy, and precious name we pray. Amen. 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 Yes, let's give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Father. Now it's time for a little fellowship. I want you to get out of your seats. Go say hi to somebody. Somebody you didn't come to church with. Talk to somebody you don't know. Good to see you. Praise God. Amen, amen. Yes, Lord. Praise God, praise God. All right, y'all are being a little too social out there. Praise the Lord. Amen. We'll ask for you to make your way back to your seats now. Thank you all, thank you all. Praise God. God is good. All the time. Amen, amen. If you're here with us at Grace Church, or it's been a long time since you've been here, we're happy you came to worship with us. If you would like to, fill out the visitor cards in the seat backs there and put them in the offering plate. All we need is your name and number, and we'd like to connect with you. And we're so happy you came to worship with us today. Amen, church? Amen. Praise God. Praise God. You know, I was going to propose to my girlfriend this week, but my dog ate the ring. Yeah. Now it's just a diamond in the rough. Diamond in the rough. That joke was a little rough. Also, I don't have a girlfriend. Speaking of rough, you're going to have a rough week if you don't join us for all the great stuff we have going on, starting with men's prayer, Wednesday at 7 a.m. Men of God, come to pray it Wednesday mornings. It's a time of sacrifice, giving up of ourselves, waking up early, and seeking God's face. So if you're able to do that, we'll encourage you to join us for that. Also, we've got Wednesday evening prayer at 6:30 p.m., and that's corporate prayer for all of us. And that's a time where I think this week we'll definitely be giving God a lot of glory and honor and praise. We definitely have been pressing in the last few weeks with a lot of issues with our country, with our cities, and now it's time to give God some glory. So we're looking forward to corporate prayer and how that turns out. Just thankfulness to God and all he's doing. And also this weekend, we have our men's and women's breakfast. If you can make it to that, we'd love to have you. Men will be at Perkins at 9 a.m. Ladies, you'll be here at the church at 9 a.m. and bring a breakfast food item, I believe. Amen. Amen. I'm getting a yes. So, yes. Amen. So, with that, we're going to keep it nice and quick today. We'll invite the ushers to come forward for the giving of our tithes and offerings. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for your goodness and your glory. Lord, you're so kind to us. Lord, we ask, Lord, as we give today, we would do it with hearts of joy, thankfulness, and gratitude towards all you've poured out upon us, God. No matter what we face, you have been kind. And so, Lord, we give back to our church today that feeds us, that helps us, and, Lord, that helps to deliver us from the hand of the enemy. And, Lord, we ask as our pastor brings the word that you would continue to transform our hearts as you were doing in worship, Lord, throughout today, Lord. We don't want just a good message that makes us feel good and encourages us, but, Lord, we want transformational change by your Spirit, Lord. Change us uniquely, Lord, foundationally and fundamentally to be a people that love you first. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
And no, children, you are not dismissed yet. I know I was getting some stares from the kids. We're actually going to be doing something really quick that is powerful, that is amazing. And whenever we do things like this, I always feel like the children need to stay up so that you can see and watch how the church is ran and how we do things. Because that's how the younger generation grows, is by us being the example and showing them how to do Christ. Amen? But this morning, we have a very special thing taking off first place right now, is we are going to be doing a baby dedication this morning. Now, Christian realm, we don't believe in baby baptisms, right? Because baptism is a choice. It's part of your relationship that you have with Jesus Christ, right? It's a willing choice that you make representing the death and resurrection of Christ, that you're joining him in death and resurrection. We believe in baby dedications and baby blessings, though. Because we are dedicating them to the God, or into God's hands. We are blessing them into God's hands. So this morning, I'm going to have Tyler and Daria McClymonds come forward and bring little James. And if Daria's family wants to join us as well. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I love Oh, my wife as well. I'm going to have my wife join me. Amen. Hallelujah. She's pretty, but that's okay. Anyways, we're talking about a baby. But baby dedications. Right here, we got in his dapper little suit going on. We got James Tyler McClymans looking good. I've made a habit of not holding. Well, yeah, you look good. You do. Amen. Well, he's eyeballing me, though. He's going, I don't know about this guy. But baby dedications are a very special, blessed thing. It's where we come before God as parents, dedicating a child into the hands of God, with their family surrounding them, and also us as a church standing and taking a claim saying, hey, we're going to take our part in the life of this child as well. Because when we believe in the body of Christ doesn't just begin and end with the family. It begins and ends with the body. We are all a part of James's life. We all take part in raising him into the ways of God. Amen? And as we were kind of talking about this, Tyler and Daria, they chose a portion of scripture that we're going to look at this morning. James chapter 1, verses 12 through 15. Do we have that for the board this morning? So it starts off by saying, blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial. For when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. But blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial. See, the amazing thing about this portion of scripture is Tyler and Daria. That's your job. To raise James up in the ways of the Lord. To raise him up into a man who can stand fast under trial. It's a heavy burden, but it's a glorious burden. Because as you walk with Christ, he observes your walk. And he follows that walk. See, I also kind of want to take a moment because as parents, it's your job to speak into his life as well. In Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, we see Isaiah, he's prophesying over who the Messiah is going to be. He calls him Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace. He's speaking into the very existence of who Jesus was going to be. Not only the things he was going to be, but his nature and his character. See, as parents, you have the ability to speak into his life. You have the ability to speak to his life, saying to James, you are going to be a mighty warrior, a man of God. As parents, that is what you do. Speak into his life. Show him and raise him up in the ways of the Lord. Showing him how to abide in Christ. It's up to you to form his identity in Christ by speaking life into him, identity into him. The very nature and character of who Christ is and what Christ has in store for him, speaking that into his life. And as we continue on in James chapter 1, verse 12 through 15, it says, let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it is conceived, gives birth to sin. And sin, when it fully grows, brings forth death. And you're sitting there going, well, how does this deal with baby dedication? Because if the church raises him up, if the church walks with him, if the church guides him, if the church is the example for him, he understands and he knows how to walk with Christ, how to avoid temptation, having that knowledge founded in who Christ is. So this morning, we're going to take a couple of things. And I want to speak first and foremost to the church. Because church, the baby dedication is a covenant between the family and God and how that child will be raised. But it's so much easier for that child to be raised in the ways of God if the church is being Christ as well. So I'm going to talk to you this morning for a second. That in your own walk with Christ, can you promise to be an example to James? Can you promise to stand firm upon the word of God as Christ as your foundation? If you will, say we will. Amen. Tyler and Daria, as parents of James, will you promise to raise James up in the principles and wisdom of the Father and Jesus Christ, his Son? And in doing so, set him upon a strong start and strong foundation in Christ. If you will, say we will. Daria's family, parents, sister and brother-in-law, right? Will you promise to stand firm and be the example, not only with the parents, but the example of Christ to James as he's raised up as well? Well, amen. What I want us to do this morning is I want us to stand, stretch our hands out to this family. Stretch your hands out to James, to Tyler, and to Daria. And as we start praying, I want you to start declaring goodness, grace, mercies upon him. I'm going to have Pastor Randy, I'm actually going to have you anoint your grandson. I want you to pray blessings over your grandson as the patriarch. So Father, right now we just come before you. You are holy, you are mighty, you are great. God, you are amazing. You are the giver of life. You are the one who created life, and you knew James even before he was conceived in their parents' mind. You knew him for who he is, for who he's going to be, and you are laying down the foundation of his walk even right now in this moment. Your word tells us that your word is the light into our path and the lamp unto our feet. That means you are guiding us actively in this walk with Christ. So Holy Spirit, have your way right now upon James. Have your way upon his heart. Have your way upon his life. And I declare right now that we bless Tyler and we bless Daria right now to be the parents that you've called them to be. Tyler, to be the man, to be the husband, to be the father of his home, the man of God that you have called them to be. Rise up, man of valor, right now in Jesus' name. And we anoint Daria right now to be the wife, not the servant, not the slave, but the partner, walking beside her husband, helping him to be the man that you've called him to be. Walking with him in ministry, walking with him where you are calling them and leading them. And as they walk together for James, we just declare that right now in Jesus' name. We declare these things and so much more in the mighty and the holy name of Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Now we do also have a certificate of dedication and a first Bible. Amen. Amen. Let's go ahead and give a round of applause one more time for this amazing event. Hallelujah. Okay, children, you are dismissed. Hallelujah. See, it's a beautiful thing when the church is actively being the church. Amen? When we're actively following and doing the things that God has called us to do. And I think a lot of times, especially when it comes to the younger generation, we forget that the younger generation is a part of the body of Christ. And it's our job as the church to lead, to guide, and to raise them up in the ways of the Lord. Amen? But this morning, let's dive right into it. We are continuing in our series going over the how-tos. In this series, we've been talking about how to do life, how to do this walk with Christ according to the Word of God. Amen? Because anytime we step away from the Word of God and try to live life our own way, that's not according to the Word of God. Amen? That's walking a walk in our own strength and our own might and our own opinions. Amen? But we are called to walk according to the word and to the will of God. And we have to understand that if we want to go deeper into the things of God, what do we have to do? We have to decrease in ourselves. We have to go lower still, right? If we want to go higher into the calls of God, higher into the ways of God, we have to diminish our flesh and our Holy Spirit to increase within us. And as we do these how-tos and as we walk with Christ, we have to understand that without humility as our primary focus, without humility and without relationship as our primary focus, we cannot walk this walk that we call sanctification, can we? Because it's called a walk in our own strength if we do it without humility and without relationship. Amen? Amen. We have to walk with God with humility, with relationship. And as we do that, our walk becomes works of fruit instead of works of the flesh. And today, we're going to talk about another Christianese word that we like to say in the church. But I want to read a portion of Scripture. I want to open up with Matthew chapter 5, verse 13, first and foremost. Matthew chapter 5, verse 13 says, "You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt has become tasteless, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men." You are the salt of the earth. So this morning we're going to be talking about how to be the salt of the earth. How are we, as believers in Jesus Christ, how are we to be the salt of the earth this morning? Now, I want to talk about salt just for a little bit. In our modern viewpoint, in everybody's viewpoint, right, salt is extremely ordinary. In fact, so when we read this, and coming from an eyes of kind of a Western culture, a modern culture, we don't really truly understand what it means to be the salt of the earth. Because salt is very average or very ordinary to us. In fact, I guarantee you, every single one of you have come into contact with salt this morning, okay? When you were bathing yourself this morning, if you bathed, hopefully you all did that, and you used soap, who used soap this morning? Okay, those of you who didn't, let's quote a non-biblical scripture, right? Cleanliness is next to godliness. You'll never find that in the Word of God. But those of you who washed yourselves, soap is primarily made out of salt. Your clothes are made with salt. The paper on your Bibles are made with salt. Salt is so common to us that a lot of times when we read the words of Jesus Christ, "You are called to be the salt of the earth," it doesn't really quite resonate with us in that regard because it is so common to us. In fact, most of you have salt, lots of salt, at your house, right? And as you go to lunch today, I guarantee you that salt, the shaker on the table, is going to be largely unnoticed across millions of cafes across the world today. No, except for you guys, because now I brought it up, you're going to be staring at it all the time you eat, right? But when we look at Scripture, and when we come to a point of view from reading the Word of God, we have to take our lens that we're reading the Word of God away from our modern culture and place it into the time that he was speaking. Because when Jesus was talking, I guarantee you the people he was talking to, they understood exactly the reference he was making. They knew what he was talking about when Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth," because they understood the importance of salt at that time. See, at that time, salt wasn't just this thing that was ordinary, it was used for everything. It was a valuable thing that you cherished, that you held on to. Salt was used to preserve food. It was used in healing. They used salt as an antiseptic. They used salt as payment and a currency. In fact, if you look at the Roman soldiers were paid in gold and in salt, right? So if you're looking at the concept of salt back then, salt was extremely valuable. It was also used as a form of destruction as well. Because if you look at the Word of God, half of the point of Scripture when it mentions salt is from a position of judgment. In fact, when the Romans went into a culture and they destroyed a culture, they would raise the fields and they would salt the fields. What that would do is it would make the fields unable to grow fruit. It would make it useless. So salt was used as a form of judgment as well. So when Jesus is talking about salt here, he's talking about it as something that is extremely valuable, something that holds high importance. And these people who he was speaking to understood exactly what he was talking about. And as we as believers, we have to understand what it truly means when we are called to be the salt of the earth. Salt at that time had so much more to do than just flavoring food. I heard it said like this week, and I wanted to kind of share it. But this pastor said it like this. He said, "Followers of Jesus are like salt. Although we're ordinary and everywhere and get involved in pretty much everything, whether we're noticed or not, we also have a variety of roles to play as God's kingdom comes on earth." So this morning, we're going to talk about salt and how we as believers are called to be the salt of the earth. The first thing that we are called to do as believers in Christ, we are called to be flavoring. We are called to bring flavor to the world, okay? Now, I'm going to explain what I mean by that. But coming back from a lens of modern view, salt a lot of times makes food taste better. Right? It makes food taste better. How many of you like fish and chips? How many of you likes the French fries with no salt on them? I see one hand. We have to talk about that later. Because salt makes something that is bland good, right? Salt also brings out the natural flavors of something. In fact, when I make a steak, salt is one of the four ingredients that I use to make my steak, right? It's also used to create a contrast, what we call salt and or sweet and salty, right? Sometimes you really want something that's sweet. Sometimes you really want something that's salty. Put them together, and it's like heaven on your mouth. And this is how we typically think of salt. See, but it's also something that we're called to be. When we're looking at the Word of God and we look at Matthew chapter 28 and also Mark chapter 16, the Great Commission, what does Jesus tell us to do? He tells us to stay put and do nothing, right? No, he tells us to go. Go. Make disciples of men. He tells us to go preach the Word of God, raise the dead, heal the sick, cast out demons. That tells me that all of those things are very possible for us as believers in Christ to do, and we should be doing. Amen? But he tells us to go in an attitude of bringing flavor to the world. And I believe that Jesus was telling his followers, instructing us to enhance the flavor of life in this world, enriching and making God's work and his word stand out in contrast to the ways of the world. Amen? Adding that flavor to the world, adding that, showing that there's something else besides the depths and the pit that they are in right now. We are to be called set apart from the world, not a part of the world. We're called to be in the world, though. Amen? Go is what Christ tells us to do. And I love what he says in Luke chapter 6, verses 35 and 36. He says, but love your enemies. Do good to them. That's such a powerful statement from Jesus Christ right there. Love your enemies. Do good to them. Don't do evil to them. Don't tear them down. Don't mock them. Don't belittle them. Do good to them. Amen? And lead them or lend to them without expecting to get anything back. I know my grandfather would always say that it's easier to give than to lend because the return is about the same. You're not going to get it back usually. But see, if we love our enemies, if we do good to them, if we supply them and give or meet their needs that they have in the moment, this is the reward. Then your reward will be great if you love your enemies, if you do good to them, if you meet their needs when they're in a position of needing something, right? Then your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High because he is kind to the ungrateful and to the wicked. Jesus died for them as well. Amen? He gave his son for them as well. Be merciful just as your Father is merciful. See, when we behave in ways that reflect the very nature and character of God, we show the difference that Jesus has made in our life, and we show the difference that Jesus has for their life as well. And as believers, there's no greater time than right now to be Christ, to add flavor to the world, to be the salt of the world. Because right now, our country, in this moment, is more divided than any time before. There's more of a separation right now than any other time before. And we as believers in Christ have a choice that we have to make right now. We can choose, if you voted red, we can choose to mock and belittle the people who voted blue. You can choose to make fun of them. You can choose to belittle them. You can choose to mock them. You can choose to not be Christ. Amen? But you can also choose to show them Christ. You can choose to show them mercy. You can choose to show them grace. You can choose to show them love. That choice is in your hands. Because the thing about it is this, that we have to understand. I want everybody to hear me right now. Man or woman is not going to save this country. God is the one who's going to save this country. The moment you put your trust in man is the moment you step out of the will of God. Amen? Because the Word of God tells me that he places all authority. The Word of God tells me that He places all rulers. He places all kingdoms. He places all authority. And if we are standing upon that, we have to place our trust in God and not in man, because God orchestrates all things. He sets up all things for His will and His way and His perfect plan for this nation, for this country, and for yourselves. Amen?
Amen.
So instead of mocking and belittling people, join with them and show them Christ. Because our trust is in God. It is not in man. And as believers, as Christians, we are called to show Christ to the world. God told us, go ahead and put Matthew 5 up back up there, 13. He called us, that He said that you are the salt of the earth, right? He did not say you are the salt of the church. That means we are called to go. Salt does no good if it stays left in the shaker, right? You've got to shake it. You've got to move it. You've got to put it on your food. And as we are the salt of the earth, God has called us to go, right? Go and be Christ to the hurting. Go and be Christ to those who are in fear. Go and be Christ to those, because where the Spirit of the Lord is, what comes? There is freedom, and we carry the presence of God upon us. We carry the Holy Spirit within us, upon us, around us. So where we go, freedom goes before us. But it doesn't happen if we stay sitting in one place. We have to move. Amen?
Amen.
Now, I'm not telling you that you got to get involved in outreach. I'm telling you, you've got to be Christ in the world. Amen? Outreach is an offering of your time. Being Christ is a calling that you have in place upon you as a lifestyle and relationship founded in Jesus Christ. Church, we are intended to spread throughout the world and enhance it, adding flavor to things that would be bland, drawing out the blessings of whatever is good, and providing contrast to being different and distinct from the ways of the world. Colossians chapter 4, 5, and 6 says this: walk in wisdom towards outsiders, making the best use of your time. Some of the people you meet, that's the only time you're going to meet them. Make the best use of your time. Are you being Christ in that moment? Are you showing them the love of Christ in that moment? Are you showing them an alternate relationship in that moment? Amen? Make the best use of the time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt. This does not give... You know, I've actually heard people use this verse to be salty, right? A lot of the younger generation knows what that means, right? But my wife would kind of say it like this. When she says something that I find harsh, when she says something that kind of puts me off, or says something that's, you know, it hurts me, right? But when she does that, I'm like, man, babe, that's really harsh. She's like, no, I'm just being honest, right? I'm like, well, honesty hurts sometimes. But let your grace or your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt. What does that mean? It means as you talk, you are not talking your own words. You are talking the edification and the glorification of Jesus Christ. In your speech, you should be lifting Christ on high. In your speech, you should be speaking life instead of death. In your speech, have it be seasoned with the salt that is the goodness of God, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. Church, we are called to be the salt of the earth. We are called to change the atmosphere with the flavor that we carry, who is Jesus Christ, our Lord, and His Spirit upon us. Amen?
Amen.
Number two, the second thing about being the salt of the earth, man, we are called as preservers. We are preserving the world. We are preserving the world. Because again, looking back at Jesus and when He was speaking, we have to put our lenses on again of who He was talking to and the time He was talking. Because salt in the ancient world, specifically around Jesus' time, was used as a form of refrigeration, right? It was used as a preservative. In fact, if you wanted to have meat and fish last longer, you would rub salt on it. That salt would make it edible longer. It would keep away the rot, right? It would keep away the rotting of that, because salt slows the natural decay of something that is rotting. And Jesus called us as His followers to be the salt of the earth. He calls us to be the salt, preserving something that is dying, being the healing balm to something that is rotting, keeping the rot away. Amen? He didn't call the church to be sugar. He called us to be salt. Because sugar, while sweet, enhances rot. And the moment we as believers step away from the Word of God, step away from the principles of the Word of God, step away from those things and say, in my opinion, we are stepping out of that and we are teaching and saying sugar things instead of salt things. Because salt chases away rot. It does not enhance rot. It does not justify sin. Amen? He called us that way. Now, yes, we are called to be kind. We're called to speak in love. But speak in love, the truth, and the Word of God. Amen? Because the message that we carry comes into direct conflict with the message and the desires of the world. And if we are bringing down the salt of our message, right? If we are bringing down the impact of Christ in our message, we are no longer adding salt to the world, but rather we're adding sugar to the world, something that is sweet. Because ultimately it's going to taste good, but it's going to enhance the spiritual rot of the people that we are talking to. See, I want you to listen very carefully to how Jesus prayed in John 17. Listen to his prayer. Focus on what Jesus prayed. This is when he is in the garden and he's praying over his people. He says, make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word, which is truth. We are made holy by the word of God. Amen? So if we are the salt of the earth, we are teaching and we are preaching truth, which makes us holy. Holiness is in direct conflict with fleshliness. Amen? So we are called to be holy, making the word of God truth to us. Just as you sent me into the world, I am sending them into the world. And he's not just speaking here about the 12. He's speaking about you. He's talking about each and every one of us. Amen? And I give myself as a holy sacrifice for them so they can be made holy by your truth. Let's go on. I am praying not only for these disciples, but also for all who will ever believe in me through their message. See, even in that moment, Christ wasn't just focused upon the 12. He wasn't just focused upon the 70. He wasn't just focused upon those who were following him at the time. He was focused on every single person who was going to call him Lord. And he is declaring them that the truth is going to make them free. The truth is going to make them holy. The truth is going to go before them. Amen? I pray that they will all be one. Just as you and I are one. As you are in me, Father, and I am in you. And may they also be in us so that the world will believe you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me so that they may be one as we are one. I am in them, and you are in me. May they experience such perfect unity that the world will know that you sent me and that you love them as much as you love me. Father, I want these whom you have given me to be with me where I am. Then they can see all the glory you gave me because you loved me even before the world began. Oh, righteous Father, the world doesn't know you, but I do. And these disciples know you sent me. I have revealed you to them, and I will continue to do so. Then your love for me will be in them, and I will be in them. Church, that is the cry of Christ over you. That is the prayer of Christ over each and every one of your hearts and over each and every one of your lives, that you would walk in the truth, that you would speak the truth, right? Not to be lifted on high, but that you could be made holy by the truth that you carry within you, right? That you could be made holy and that you could show other people holiness based on the truth that you speak into their hearts and into their lives. We are called to come against the rot in their hearts. Amen? Come against that rot that is trying to carry them away. We carry the very word of truth, the message of truth, with the intent that we will be made holy by the truth of the Father. And we as disciples of Jesus Christ are sent into the world not to add to the decay, but to keep the decay away. Amen? To keep that at bay. We are sent to preserve its goodness and prevent it from falling into corruption and ruin. It's our job to call out sin, church. It's our job to confront sin. And you can say, well, Pastor, that's judging people. We're called to judge the church. I am called to call out sin in your life. You are called to call out sin in my life. The moment we tolerate sin is the moment we start adding sugar into someone's life. Amen? The moment we start doing that is the moment we start justifying. I'm getting ahead of myself. But we are called to come against sin. Sin is a sickness and a rot that is killing people around you every single day. You are called to confront that. You are called to preserve that away from them. Amen? John 6:63 says this. It says, it is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and are life. We carry life in our words. We carry that ability to speak life into people's hopelessness, into their fear, into their situations. We speak life into those things as the salt of the earth. Because Hebrews 4:12 says this about the Word of God. It says, for the Word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword and piercing as far as the division of soul and spirit, of both joints and marrow, and able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. The sword is the Word of God. You carry the Word of God in your hearts if you have set that word upon your heart. Amen? Amen? But the Word of God is spirit and life, and it is living and active. And when quickened by Holy Spirit, it has the dynamic power to change people's lives. Each and every one of you have come into direct clashing, right, with the Word of God. And you've made the choice to either choose to hear the Word of God or to reject the Word of God. See, but when we go out into the world, it's not you that they're rejecting. That's one thing we have to understand, right? It's not you that they reject. It's very Christ who they reject. You are the mouthpiece of Holy Spirit bringing that preservation, that word of preservation into the world. They don't reject you. They reject Christ. That is not on you. Your job is to be obedient to the Word of God. Your job is to go. Holy Spirit's job is to do the change in their hearts and their lives. Amen? We are called to be the salt of the earth. Salt doesn't just savor, but it saves. And number three, we can lose our saltiness. We can become in a position of losing our saltiness. So how does salt lose its saltiness? Because it's very possible to do. Jesus not only gives us the warning in Matthew 5:13, but he also gives us a warning found in Mark chapter 9 as well. I'm going to look at Matthew 5:13 one more time, though. It says, you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt has become tasteless, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under the foot of men. Jesus also says this in Mark chapter 9:49-50. He says, for everyone will be seasoned with fire, and every sacrifice will be seasoned with salt. Salt is good, but if the salt loses its flavor, how will you season it? Have salt in yourselves and have peace with one another. Now, when we're looking at salt, salt typically does not lose its saltiness. The nature of salt does not change. And in fact, you can buy a big old thing of what, Milton? Milton salt, is that the popular salt? I don't know, Angie does all the shopping. Morton, thank you. Knew it started with an M, hallelujah. But you can go out and buy a big thing of Morton salt, put it on your pantry, in your shelf, and it's going to stay salty for 20 years. Amen? It's not going to lose its saltiness. It's not going to lose that flavor to be salty. It's going to keep its natural phase until it's gone. But let me tell you this. I've done some research. I did a little bit of research on this. The only way that salt loses its saltiness is if it is influenced by impurities or diluted. If salt is exposed to water, the sodium chloride that makes salt can be dissolved and removed. And the salt will lose the essence of its saltiness. It will still look like salt. Its appearance doesn't change. But it loses its effectiveness of what it was meant to do. What does that mean for us, though? How can we lose our saltiness? Romans chapter 12, verse 2 says this. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. But the very first thing is, do not be conformed to the world. Do not be conformed to the ways of the world. Amen? In the Jude chapter 1. Now, I know last week I gave you all some homework. I told you to read Titus and I told you to read Jude. Titus is literally like 2 pages. Jude is 1 page. So if you didn't do that, you need to go do it again this week. Amen? Read Titus and read Jude because it's so, so good. And you can't say, well, I just don't have the time. It's 1 page. If you don't have time to read 1 page, there's a lot more going on that we need to talk about. Amen? Amen. Read Jude, because Jude is so powerful. And Jude says this, but you, beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, building yourselves up. It's a work that you put into. It's something that you put effort into, is building up your faith. Praying in the Holy Spirit. Man, if you can speak in tongues, speak in tongues. Pray in tongues constantly. Amen? Keep yourselves in the love of God. Keep yourselves in the love of God. That tells me that I have the option to step out of the will of God. Amen? I want to be kept. Who wants to be kept this morning? I want to be kept in the love of God, waiting anxiously for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ to eternal life. Let me say it like this. We lose our saltiness by letting our faith become diluted. We lose our saltiness by letting our word, our speech become watered down, by letting our message become watered down. We lose our saltiness when we preach a weak, tasteless, and flat gospel. As I was thinking about this, I wrote some things down of how we lose our saltiness. We lose our saltiness when our message becomes watered down and we begin to justify and accept sin instead of standing upon the word of God. We lose our saltiness when we begin to conform the word of God to become accepting instead of dividing. When we make the word of God say something that justifies my sin instead of convicts me of my sin, you've lost your saltiness. We lose our saltiness when we as Christians become complacent, allowing every wind of doctrine in our life instead of standing upon the word of God. If it doesn't line up with Scripture, you shouldn't be giving it attention. Amen? I don't care who's speaking it. Even Paul said of himself, test everything I say under the word of God. If I say it, you better check it. Don't take my word for it. Follow it up with Scripture. Amen? Because there's so many things that twist the word of God now. There's so many people who twist it to their own gain, and we have to know the word of God. And if you're letting your ears be tickled by something that tickles your flesh, it's not the word of God, because the word of God always brings you into a correction and alignment with the word, with him. Amen? If it brings you away from God, get rid of it. We lose our saltiness when we begin to use Scripture to justify our life and our sin in light of progression. We lose our saltiness when we become I-centered instead of him-centered. I think this. In my opinion. It doesn't matter what your opinion is. If it doesn't line with the Word of God, you shouldn't be saying it. Amen? We start to say things like this instead of what the Word of God says. We lose our saltiness when we water down the truth, appealing to our flesh. And when we do that, when we water down the gospel for the sake of someone's opinions or the sake of someone's feelings, when we water down the gospel to protect someone else's emotions, is the moment that we step into alignment with the enemy and what he wants for the world. When we become complacent, when we become compliant, when we become all of these things that take us away from the will of God, we actually step into the will of the enemy. You guys have to realize that. When we water down the gospel, we're no longer effective. We're no longer speaking truth. We are now justifying sin. We are now making sin acceptable according to the word of God. We lose our saltiness when we allow the word to become a greater influence upon our life and in our life instead of the word and presence of God. 2 Peter 1, 5 and 11 says this. For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness mutual affection, and to mutual affection love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive. If we follow the will and the way of God, following his nature and having his nature and character become a part of us, right? They will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their past sins. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, make every effort to confirm your calling and election. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. That's a promise of God. But it takes effort on your part to walk a willing life according to the word of God. Amen? But I love that. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. You will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Colossians chapter 2, 6 and 9 says this. And now, just as you accepted Christ Jesus as your Lord, you must continue to follow him, right? Sometimes us in the church like to just stop following Christ. Well, I'm getting into heaven. I'm good, right? I got my get out of jail card with the blood of Jesus Christ upon me. But that's not what Paul is saying here. That you must continue to follow him. Let your roots grow down into him. How does that happen? By having relationship with God. By developing that relationship with him. I was talking to a young man the other day. And he was talking about that he can't just find, he was having a hard time finding a girlfriend. And I was like, well, are you looking? Are you striving after? Are you pursuing? Are you doing anything effective to actually catch the eye of a woman? See, and in our relationship with God, if you are not moving towards him, you're not moving anywhere. Part of your relationship with Christ is pursuing Christ. And the moment you take that first step, Christ is meeting you right then and there. But it takes that effort from you deciding to follow him, putting effort into the relationship. Amen? I talk about my relationship with my wife all the time. And I know that if I did not pursue her, I would not have her. Right? And you could ask her, man, she did not pray for a tall, skinny, bearded white guy. But she got a tall, skinny, bearded white guy because I pursued her. I saw her. I wanted her. I pursued her. I got her. I kept her. And I'm continuing to pursue her. That's the same thing that we have in our relationship with Jesus Christ. We get him because he died for us. He gave himself up for us. We get his word. We hold his word to our heart. We continue to pursue him because it's deeper and it's better the farther you go with him. Amen? Pursue God. Never stop following him. Let your roots grow down into him and let your lives be built on him. Last week we talked about standing firm upon the foundation that is Jesus Christ. Then your faith will go strong. I love that. Once our roots grow down into God, once our roots are made part of him, once he is our foundation, then your faith will go strong. Then your faith will go strong. But there's effort put into relationship first, right? Then your faith will go strong in the truth you were taught. And you will overflow with thankfulness. Oh, man. Don't let anybody capture you with empty philosophies and high-sounding nonsense that comes from human thinking and from the spiritual powers of the world. I'm telling you what, there's men and women in the church today who do not have the best effort for you in their mouths and what they speak. They are speaking from spiritual powers of this world rather than from Christ. Line everything up with the word of God. I don't care who's speaking. You might be your most favorite pastor in the world, right? It might be whoever it might be, right? It might be John Bevere. It might be any of these other great men of God. If it does not line up with the word of God, they are not speaking truth. Amen? For in Christ lives all the fullness of God in a human body. You see, we as disciples of Christ, we lose our saltiness when we compromise with the world and learn to love its ways over that of God's ways. When the world becomes more enticing, when momentary pleasure becomes more enticing to us than the presence and the word of God, we have lost our saltiness. When you would rather spend more time on your phone than the word of God, you've lost your saltiness. When you would rather spend more time watching TV, sitting down, doing nothing, instead of spending time in the word of God or praying with God or spending time with your family, you've lost your saltiness. If we've compromised ourselves and the message of God, we have lost our saltiness. But I want to end with one last scripture this morning. Because in Christ, in God, we have the ability to do something nature can't. Once salt loses its saltiness, it can never gain back its saltiness. But in God, but with Christ, we can get our saltiness back. We can come against the very nature of salt, and we can become salty again. Amen? 2 Thessalonians 3:3 tells us this. And I love this portion. I love this verse. But the Lord is faithful. The Lord is faithful, and he will strengthen you, setting you on a firm foundation, which we know is Jesus Christ, right? And will protect and guard you from the evil one. The Lord is faithful. See, when we lose our saltiness, when we compromise our walk with him, the only thing we have to do is we have to repent, right? That's the only thing you have to do. If you want your saltiness back, the only thing you have to do is repent. Come before God with a humble heart saying, God, I messed up. Man, God, I have failed you. I have failed your word. I've been a horrible example. I have neglected my relationship with you. I have done all of these things. Forgive me. And because Christ died for you, and because Christ rose again, his blood was shed for you, will forgive you of those sins, bring you back into alignment with him, bring you back into a position of righteousness in him. Because the moment we were saved, right, we talked about this a couple weeks ago, the moment we were saved, we were placed in a position of holiness, in a position of righteousness. And the walk that we make, the walk that we call sanctification, gets us from where we are into that position of holiness. All you have to do is repent, and it brings you back into a position of that path to holiness. Man, that's how faithful our God is. That's how faithful our God is. We don't have to work for it. There's nothing you can do that make God love you more. There's nothing you can do that make God love you less. He died for you. That's his love for you. Amen? He gave himself up for you. And the only way to get our saltiness back is to repent and turn back to him. Turn back into the will and the way of Christ. Because in Christ, all we have to do is repent. All we have to do is turn from our wicked ways and set our eyes on Christ, who is the author and the perfecter of our faith, and finish the race that has been placed before us. Hebrews 12:2. That's what we have to do. See, because to be effectively the salt of the earth, you have to have a relationship with him. He has to be your Lord and your Savior. If you want to add flavor to the world, if you want to add the goodness of God to your speech, you have to have a relationship with one whose speech you're talking about. To be that preserving entity, that preserving factor in the world that keeps the rot of sin away from those around us, you have to have a relationship with God. If you want to keep your saltiness, right? Not your orneriness, right? Not your harsh opinions, but if you want to be the salt of the earth, if you want to be the salt that God has called you to be, you have to have a relationship with him. Amen? Because this morning, there are some of us here who've lost our saltiness. This morning, there are some of us here who've become complacent with our walk. And you're saying, Pastor, this is harsh. So is hell. We have to get to the point where we realize that our relationship with Christ is more important than anything we have in our hearts. Our relationship with Christ is all that we have. And God is calling some of you to rise up. Stop being complacent. He's telling some of you to put down your phones and focus on him. He's telling some of you to turn off the TV and listen to his voice. He's telling some of you to get up and move, because because God has called you to do something, and you are not doing it because you are sitting in disobedience, because you are afraid of being hurt. He is calling you to something greater. He's calling some of you to get up. Stop being complacent with your walk with Him. Putting your faith in Him. He's calling some of you to be the salt of the earth. He's not calling all of us to be the salt of the earth. But He's speaking directly to some of you this morning. And I know that even in this moment, even at this time, Holy Spirit is convicting some of you of some things, of where you have been complacent in your walk with Him, of where you have been lackadaisical in your attitude towards Him. Because God wants so much better for you. And He has so much for you. Man, He desires you more than anybody else has ever desired you in history. He desires and He loves and He cherishes each and every one of you. But it takes you standing up. It takes you saying, "Here I am, God. Send me." But it takes an active choice on your part to get your saltiness back. Some of you haven't lost your saltiness. But you're tired. You're weary. You're beaten down. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. We have to understand that He is our strength. He understands your situation. In fact, He's with you in the midst of your situation. He hasn't left you. He hasn't forgotten you. He hasn't forsaken you. He is there beside you. Even in this moment, He is surrounding you. He's asking you just to give it to Him this morning. Casting your fears, your worries, your doubts, whatever that may be, placing that in His hands and leaving it in His hands. Because He is faithful to take those things from you this morning. But church, first and foremost, is that God just desires you. Christ just desires you. He wants you this morning. How great is that? To be desired by the Creator of all things. To be wanted and loved by the God who created the universe, by the very breath of His mouth spoke light and life. Desires you. Amen? Stand with me this morning. We're going to go before God for a moment. Father, You are worthy. You are holy. You are mighty. You are powerful. Great are You, God. Holy are You, Master Maker. Holy are You, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We give You thanks and we give You praise in this moment. Because You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of all of our attention. You're worthy of all of our focus. God, You are worthy of it all. And Holy Spirit, in this moment, for those of you who are talking to right now, for those that you are speaking to right now, for those who have lost their saltiness, Holy Spirit, I just declare that You move upon them now in Jesus' name. Bring them back to the place of getting their saltiness back, Father. Bring them back to the place of being the salt of the earth that You've called them to be the hands and feet that You've called them to be, Holy Spirit, of Your will and Your word and Your way. Have Your way fulfilled in their hearts and their lives right now. In the name of Jesus, I declare this. And as we stay in this attitude of prayer, I'm going to ask a question. That if you're here today, and you're saying, "Yeah, Pastor, I've lost my saltiness. I've compromised. I've become complacent. I've become in a place where you don't want me to be, Holy Spirit. If that's you this morning, I want to pray for you. And I'm going to ask you to come forward in a second, not right now, but in a second. If you're in a place this morning, you're saying, Pastor, I'm just tired. Man, I'm weary. I'm beaten down. I need a touch from Holy Spirit this morning. If that's you this morning, I'm going to have you come forward as well in a second. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands. I'm just going to ask you to come to the altar because freedom is found at the altar. So if that's you this morning, if you're saying, Pastor, I am tired, I'm beaten down, I need Holy Spirit, or you're saying, I have lost my saltiness, I am in a compromised position, I'm in a place I shouldn't be, if that's you this morning, to either of those questions, I want you to come to the altar right now. Don't look to the left, don't look to the right. Just come. Just come. Come. Yes, Jesus. You go ahead and spread out in front of the altar. Because we need room for everybody this morning. If I can get my elders, Elder Justin and Elder Joseph, to come join me as well. Right now, before we start praying for those who are here, I'm going to pray a prayer of dismissal. And if you are somebody who needs to go, you'll be dismissed. So, Father, right now, Holy Spirit, I just declare your goodness and your grace and your mercies to follow those, Father, as they leave this place this morning. To go before them as they go out of this place this morning. Holy Spirit, empower their words, empower their feet, empower their hands. Now, in Jesus' name, have them be the salt of the earth this morning, Holy Spirit. Have them go in power and in authority before you this morning, Holy Spirit. I just declare these things right now in Jesus' name.